Hello, this is Professor Kitch. Welcome to this webcast on sections 10.2 through 10.4, which covers the consolidation process. After this webcast, you should be able to describe the three most common processes that can lead to changes in effective stress in the ground. You should be able to define the term excess pore pressure, and for saturated soils, you should be able to explain how any change in total stress is initially carried by the pore water, creating excess pore pressure. And finally, you should be able to describe how this excess pore pressure dissipates and is transferred to effective stress as the soil consolidates. We learned earlier that consolidation settlement is caused by a change in effective stress. The soil will start out at some initial effective vertical stress, sigma prime z naught. A change in vertical stress, delta sigma z prime, will be caused by some process, leading to a final vertical effective stress of sigma prime zf. The change in effective stress generates the consolidation process. We will compute the initial vertical effective stress, sigma prime z naught, using our standard techniques for computing geostatic stress. But how we compute delta sigma z prime will depend on the source of the effective stress change. Remembering our fundamental equation that the effective stress is equal to the total stress minus the pore water pressure, we can see that the effective stress can be changed by either changing the total stress or changing the pore water pressure. There are three major sources of effective stress changes: placement of a fill that covers a large area on the ground surface, placement of a load on a finite-sized area, such as a square or rectangular footing, and changes to the groundwater table. The first two sources change the effective stress by changing the total stress. The third source uses a change in pore water pressure to change the effective stress. Let's look at how fill placement can change effective stress. We'll start out with a compressible layer of soil with a thickness H naught and a unit weight of gamma. The water table is at the ground surface. If we consider a point A at a depth Z below the ground surface, the initial vertical stress, sigma prime Z0, will be the total vertical stress, sigma Z, minus the pore pressure U. Or in this case, gamma times Z minus gamma water times Z. Now we place a wide fill on the soil with thickness H fill and unit weight gamma fill. By wide, we mean that the width of the fill W is much greater than the thickness of the soil layer H naught. In this case, the change in stress will be the same anywhere under the fill, and this will be a one-dimensional problem. To compute the change in vertical stress, we only need to realize that this fill now looks like just another soil layer, and the change in vertical stress is simply the geostatic stress due to the fill layer, or delta sigma z is gamma fill times H fill. The final vertical effective stress at A will be the quantity gamma times z minus gamma z water times z plus gamma fill times H fill. Example 10.1 in your text illustrates this concept for a slightly more complicated situation. Now would be a good time to pause this webcast and look through this example problem. Now let's look at stress changes due to finite size loads. Our initial conditions are as with the previous example. We're considering a point A at a depth Z below the ground surface. The initial vertical effective stress will again be gamma times Z minus gamma water times Z. But now instead of a wide fill, we'll place a square footing of width B on the ground surface above point A. The footing will apply a stress Q to the ground surface, and Q will be equal to P divided by B squared. The change in vertical stress at A will now be equal to the applied stress Q times I sub sigma. We'll have to use the stress distribution techniques we learned in Chapter 9 to determine I sub sigma. We can use either the chart solution shown here or one of the equation solutions given in Chapter 9. No matter how we determine I sub sigma, the final effective stress at A will be gamma times Z minus gamma water times Z plus Q times I sub sigma. Unlike the previous wide fill example, this problem will be three-dimensional, and the change in vertical effective stress will be different at different points in the soil layer. Now let's consider the case where the groundwater table changes. Unlike our previous two examples, in this case, the change in effective stress will be due to the change in pore water pressure rather than change in total stress. We'll start with the same soil profile as our previous example, and the initial effective stress will be the same. Now let's assume that the groundwater table in the area permanently drops to some new lower level at a height ZW above point A. This could be due to pumping of the groundwater from nearby wells or a change in climate. Rather than computing the change in effective stress due to the groundwater table drop, it's easier in this case to compute the final vertical effective stress directly using geostatic stress principles. When the water table drops, the unit weight of the soil above the water table will decrease somewhat, but we'll ignore this effect for this example and assume the unit weight is the same above and below the groundwater table. We'll compute the final vertical effective stress as the total vertical effective stress sigma z minus the pore pressure u. And at point A, the total stress will be gamma times z, and the pore water pressure will be gamma water times zw. If we want to know the change in effective stress, delta sigma z prime, we can compute it as the final vertical effective stress, sigma zf prime, minus the initial vertical effective stress, sigma z naught prime. That will expand to the quantity gamma times z minus gamma water times z water minus the quantity gamma times z minus gamma water times z, which simplifies to gamma water times the quantity z minus z water, which is simply the change in pore water pressure due to the drop in the groundwater table. So now you know how to compute both the initial vertical effective stress and the final vertical effective stress at a point due to the most common loading conditions. Which is to say, we know where a soil element starts before consolidation and where it ends up after consolidation. Now we need to discuss what happens during consolidation. Let's look back at our particulate soil model under the initial vertical effective stress, sigma z naught prime, and this phase diagram. We then add a change in vertical stress, delta sigma z. It could be due to a wide fill or a finite loaded area. Under the additional stress, the soil particles rearrange, the soil skeleton compresses to take on the additional stress, and there is a decrease in the void volume. The soil skeleton is now carrying both the initial effective stress and the additional delta sigma z, so the final effective vertical stress, that stress carried by the soil skeleton, sigma zf prime, is sigma z naught plus delta sigma z. It's very important to understand that the soil skeleton has to compress, has to undergo some strain in order to carry this additional stress. Just like any other solid material, the additional stress comes with strain. Now let's consider the same soil element, but this time it's saturated, all the voids are filled with water, and this is our phase diagram. Since the soil is saturated, we need to know the pore pressure, so we'll install a pressure gauge in the pore fluid, and its initial reading will be the static pore water pressure, U0. The total stress at this time, sigma z naught, is sigma z naught prime plus U naught. We again apply a stress to increase the sample, delta sigma z. However, now things are different. For the soil skeleton to compress and take on the additional stress, the water has to flow out of the pores. The problem is this doesn't occur instantly. Because of the finite hydraulic conductivity of the soil, it takes some time for the water to flow out of the soil. So the instant delta sigma z is applied, the total stress is increased by the same amount. However, if the soil skeleton hasn't compressed, then it can't have taken on an additional stress, so there is no change in effective stress. So where has the additional delta sigma z gone to? In order to keep our equation balanced, there's only one place for it to go, and that's the pore pressure. there must be an increase in the pore pressure, which we'll call the excess pore pressure, U sub E. And it should be apparent that this excess pore pressure must be equal to delta sigma Z. So if we watch our pressure gauge, it must jump up by U sub E the instant the stress delta sigma Z is applied. We call this increase in pore pressure excess pore pressure because it is temporary and will go away, as we'll see in just a moment. Right now, we're looking at a point frozen in time, the instant after the additional stress has been applied. However, time waits for no student, so we'll turn the clock back on. And as time goes on after the application of delta sigma Z, three things will happen at the same time. The soil starts to compress, the pore pressure decreases, and as the soil skeleton compresses, the effective stress increases. The process continues until the pore pressure has returned to the original static pore pressure, U naught. By this time, all the increase in stress has been transferred from pore pressure to effective stress, and the final vertical effective stress, sigma Zf prime, is the sum of sigma Z naught prime plus delta sigma Z. So when a soil is saturated, the consolidation process takes time, just as we saw in the Kansai Airport case history. Initially, when the stress increases, all the additional stress is taken by the pore pressure, creating an excess pore pressure. The excess pore pressure forces water out of the soil. As the water leaves, the soil skeleton starts to compress, taking on additional stress. At the same time, the pore pressure is decreasing. This continues until all the additional stress is transferred from excess pore pressure to effective stress. We can also use the piston and spring analogy to explain consolidation. In this analogy, we have a piston and a cylinder placed in a large water bath. The piston has two small holes drilled in it with valves that open and close. Under the piston is a spring, and we have a pressure gauge to measure the water pressure in the cylinder. In this analogy, the spring represents the soil skeleton and carries the effective stress. The water inside the cylinder represents the pore pressure. We start with a load on the piston which generates our initial conditions. The total stress is sigma naught, the initial pore pressure is U naught, and the initial stress carried by the spring, sigma prime naught, will be sigma naught minus U naught. We add an additional stress to the piston, delta sigma, but the valves in the piston are kept closed. With the valves closed, no water can leave the cylinder, so the piston does not move. The spring cannot compress, so the effective stress cannot increase. Therefore, the only way to balance out the increased total stress is for an excess pore pressure to be created. The magnitude of the excess pore pressure will be equal to the stress increase, delta sigma. We then open the valves in the piston, allowing water to flow out of the cylinder into the larger reservoir. However, the holes are very small and restrict the flow, simulating the hydraulic conductivity of the soil. As the water slowly leaks out of the holes, the pore pressure reduces, the piston moves down, and the spring takes up more stress. That is, stress is being transferred from the pore pressure to the spring. Since the spring represents the effective stress in the soil skeleton, we see the effective stress rise. Eventually, the pore pressure returns to U naught. All of the stress increase, delta sigma, has been transferred to the spring, and the final effective stress, sigma F prime, is equal to the initial effective stress plus delta sigma. And all the change in stress has been transferred from excess pore pressure to effective stress. In the field, the process is very similar. We have a compressible layer with an initial thickness H naught. At some point A in the soil, there is an initial vertical stress, sigma V naught, pore pressure U naught, and effective stress, sigma V naught prime. In the field, it takes time to construct the fill, and therefore the load is applied over some period of time rather than instantaneously. Initially, the induced stress, delta sigma V, all goes to excess pore pressure, and there is no change in effective stress. After the fill is placed, the excess pore pressure starts to dissipate, the effect of vertical stress increases and the fill settles. The total consolidation settlement is delta sub c. Let's summarize. Consolidation settlement is a process that starts with a change in total stress. For a saturated soil with finite hydraulic conductivity, the change in stress must initially be carried by the pore water pressure, creating excess pore pressure. With time, water is forced out of the soil due to the excess pore pressure. As water leaves, the pore water is reduced and the soil compresses. As the soil compresses, the skeleton is able to pick up the additional stress and the effective stress increases. In the end, all of the increase will end up as effective stress. The soil compressibility and hydraulic conductivity will control how fast the soil consolidates. Example 10.2 in your text goes through the process of computing change in effective stress during consolidation for the soil profile shown here. You should go through this example before class.
Eso es todo, amigos.